Morning, everyone, and to the distant learners. Today we're going to talk about classification societies, inspection, certificates, and surveys in general. The contents of this presentation regard the framework of surveys and certificates, class surveys and certificates, statutory surveys, onboard surveys, and some other types of surveys that occur. We have to define the reason and the aims for surveys, the instruments to verify compliance, and all of after that, the summary of the surveying. So, first of all, do you know any reasons and aims for why we have to do a survey in a ship? Any ideas? Yeah.
Double check that everything is in compliance.
Yeah.
With the rules.
Yes.
The regulations.
Okay, yes.
Ensure the safety operation on the ship.
Ensure the safety operation, yes, that's correct. Both of them are correct. Something else?
Monitor the performance of the ship.
Monitor the performance.
In accordance with the class requirements.
That's true. Yeah, yeah. All of you are correct. And, yes, the reasons and aims are to ensure the quality of the ship, the quality of the cargo holds, the safety of crew, that's very important, the seaworthiness of the vessel, something about life extension of the vessel to increase her life, corrosion trend analysis, especially for ballast tanks, that's quite important, to repair and maintenance requirements, insurance. Maybe insurance is something complicated here because a lot of parties involved in this type of operations. Sell and purchase, so for the new buyer to know the exact condition of the vessel. The working conditions, survey after repair, if there is a damage convention, etc. Convention requirements, design and structural details, to detect some problem areas, future inspection requirements, and some agreements, and many, many others. And the instruments to verify compliance, we have the plan approval. So the plan approval includes the ship security plan, as we discussed last week. Some plans regarding MARPOL regulations, plan approval from new buildings, stability, you're correct, and many other, especially before the ship sails. And after that, we have certificate that comes from survey, audit, and verification. And for example, we have safety surveys regarding SOLAS stability requirements. We have class certificate that's very important. We have statutory, we have some audits regarding the ISM and the, that's quite important, maybe Argyro knows about this type of audits, and the International Ship Security Certificate, a lot of types of certificates. And surveys. Divided into three parts. First of all, regards the classification that is dependent on the classification rules of each classification society, and the class certificate after the vessel successfully passed the survey. We have statutory surveys that is depend on laws and regulations, and classification society is approved for the flag to carry out this statutory surveys. That depends on the classification society and the flag that provides the license, let's say, the monitor and license to carry out these surveys. And of course, we have some other types of surveys that depend on contracts and agreements, and reports arise from them. So we're going to talk about the basic definitions of classification, The surveys and certificates about new buildings, ships in operation, and some special procedures that we are carrying out. The ships are designed to and construct and maintain to meet the requirements of the classification rules, the IMO conventions, the relevant national regulations, i.e. statutory regulation, and level standards according to ISO, DIN, and many others. And what's classification? Classification regards both the hull, the machinery, electrical installation, and cargo refrigerating installation, on, if there is any, on board. So classification society, classification survey deals with these three objects, let's say, of surveying. We have to, each vessel has to be characterized from the classification society. So, for example, we have here a container vessel, and this vessel, according to most of the IX classification societies, follow this procedure for classification, and some of them that they're not also from belong to IX society. This Maltese cross means that the vessel is built under supervision according to classification rules. So when we see this cross regarding this vessel, that means that the classification society that also monitors the ship was built also from her, from its yes, from its supervision and from the rules and regulations of this classification society. This number means that the hull complies 100% with the classification society rules. So this number may vary. Sometimes it should be less than 100. The A5 means that the classification, the class should be renewed, let's say, in 5 years. We're going to discuss this later, these 5 years, regarding the interim, the annual, and the class, let's say, renewal surveys. And finally, we have the ship type. So this Maltese Cross Hanger A5 container ship, it gives a lot of information about us. Gives a lot of information about the class that follows. The same applies for the machinery. We have here the Maltese cross. That it means that it's built under and supervised according to the classification society rules. The MC, that means that the machinery installation is in compliance with class rules, components, and material. Certification. The AOT means from automated, means that machinery spaces are equipped for unattended 24-hour operation. So this also gives us a lot of information. And also we have, that's the one, let's say, character of class. We can see regarding the hull and the machinery, the Maltese cross, this the square that it's the first Maltese cross here has a square, the second has not. That's something that each classification society maybe defines. So, yes, but actually, there is the Maltese cross, there is a common procedure of the most of the IX classification societies. Do you want to add something else to that? Yes, yes, it's a classification. It follows a different definition. Yes, these are class notations that, as you said, these are from the DNVGL, let's say, and the E calls from eye strengthening, the carriage of dangerous cargo. The call is for collisions, the IW is for in water survey, BWM is ballast water management, and there are a lot of different class notations. There are many, many of them. This is just a small amount of them. The class rules are in a constant state of evolution and development, reflecting the technical development, the experience, the research, these are regarding technology. And according to legislation, we have the IEX unified requirements. So all of the classification societies that IEX members should follow these requirements. IMO conventions and resolutions, international standards, and maybe some national requirements. So all of these define and conclude to have the classification rules. Here's a SIP life cycle and class surveys. You can see that the classification society is involved from all of the stages of the vessel, from the new building process until to the layout of the vessel. We have the supervision and plan approval before the vessel is built. We have this in during her construction, and after that we have the ship in service. We have classification and safety surveys. You can see here that every 5 years, this is because most of the classification certificates are valid for 5 years, but we have interim and annual surveys every year. This graph is regards the general procedure for the classification of the new buildings. You can see here the interaction of the shipyard classification society and ship owner client, and you can see that there is quite complicated and quite complex interaction between them. You can see the classification society should monitor the via surveys and etc. Drawing approvals, the shipyard has to provide the application for classification to the society. There is also interaction regarding the sub suppliers in the industry in order to provide components to the classification society, and classification society has to test them via a lot of methods, maybe non-destructive. But there are a lot of methods, and you can see it's quite complicated. But the classification society has a major role in the new building process of the vessel. Without the classification society, we can do anything. Maybe I can show later some drawings that they have the stamp here that it's approved. Without the stamp, the drawing means nothing. You can see here the new building procedure. The contract, when they sign the ship owner with the shipyard, the contract to end the shipyard and the classification society, the contract for the new vessel, we have a plan approval, the certification that takes part before and just after the key laying procedure, and after that we have survey in yard before the delivery. If the survey in yard is successful, then the ship should be delivered to its owners. Otherwise, they have to comply with the regulations. This survey may be there are a lot of types. Maybe there are some tests, there are sea trials, a lot of crane, maybe operation, many, many things. We have here the new building procedure regarding the plan approval and the certification. So plan approval should verify the design for compliance of material, the hull, equipment, outfitting, main machinery components and systems, electrical systems, instrumentation and automation systems, life-saving appliance. And we have to do this via class rules, international and national regulation, and recognized standards. So the certification should verify the relevant materials and components, like this that I mentioned before, that should be designed and manufactured in compliance with the class rules, etc., and supplied to the yard with certificate. So it's a very close relationship between plan approval and certification, as you can see from this graph. Regarding new building survey, have the issue it's prior to commencement of inspection and supervision during construction takes place, and we have the initial machinery survey. Some of the machinery components cannot be tested in dry dock, let's say, before the ship goes to the sea trials. That's why we have the sea trials here. We can test also the machinery components and some other characteristics of the vessel, like stability, a lot of them. Many things should drive, vibration, there are many, many things should drive. The investigation we have whether a yard is provided with suitable equipment and facilities, the when the yard has sufficiently qualified personnel, and we hold the approvals for welding that should be available. Yard's quality management should provide the information regarding the hull survey before before the inspections take place, so they should have this appropriate paperwork, let's say, or in order to prove that the yard quality management is complied with the classification society. And we can see that most of the shipyards have at least one classification society that approved their quality management. It's very important. And not only the shipyards, but also some companies that involved with the shipbuilding. We have examination regarding where the rules, regulations, and guidelines have to be applied, and all the drawings and particulars for the supervisions are available. So before the hull survey, all of the drawings should be approved from the classification society. Now we're going to the full term class certificates. We're going for where the ship is in service. We have the periodical surveys, such as annual survey. Of course, it's once per year. Intermediate survey, that's the first two or the third year, the ship owner decides when this survey takes place. We have class renewal survey, that's after 5 years. Bottom survey, boiler survey, and tail shaft survey. Maybe the tail shaft survey is also in some statutory regulations. They define the periodically of the tail shaft survey according to the what type we have for the cooling of the shaft. Let's say we have oil, we have water, seawater, fresh water, etc. We also have non-periodical surveys, such as damage and repair survey. So we have survey every time after damage of the vessel. And without the classification society did not prove that the ship is also is seaworthy, the ship cannot operate. We have voyage repairs, convention surveys. So there are a lot of examples that the ship is converted, for example, during the past years from a tanker to FPSO, and some cruise vessels increased their length, some passenger vessels the same. So there are a lot of conversions that may take place. Conversion is also, it's not a conversion, it's something else. If we, for example, fit a crane on board, this crane should be tested accordingly. We have also extraordinary surveys. And of course, we have special cases in case of change of class, and the condition assessment program. We're going to discuss this later. Sure. Voyage repairs. For example, if there is something in ship that needs to be, it's not something necessary. Let's say the classification society gives a period of, say that, okay, you can sail, but you can't. You have to fix it during the voyage. So after that, he has to approve that it's okay. And the other voyage repair means that they have to test it in voyage. So they cannot certify during before the voyage take place. Yeah. Because something else. I'm asking Panagiotis because also he's working for a classification society. That's why. Yeah. But in plan, yeah. So that's a periodical surveys made on the class. You can see here in this picture the tail sub survey. This is from this is good. We cannot yes. And this is the dry giving the dry dock. This survey was EVA cement. EVA cement 3, yeah. And Vasilia. And this is the renewal survey. So everything should be tested. All the seed chests should be opened, everything. So you can see here in this graph the surveys for class renewal from the new building survey to the issue of the first class certificate. After the first year, we have the annual survey. The second year, we have either the annual or the intermediate survey. And if we don't have the intermediate survey during the second year, this took place in the third year. It's a bit advanced compared to the annual survey. We're going to discuss it later. Otherwise, we have the annual survey. During the fourth year, we have the annual survey. And the fifth year is the endorsement of the existing certificate and the a class renewal survey should be carried out in order to issue the new certificate.
What is for all of the type of vessels?
All of the type of vessels that are classed, yeah. There are some special conditions for some other types, like
LNG,
LNG, but all of them follow the same procedure. Yes. Yes, ESP. Let me ask the students. Do you have any questions? I'm going to answer if you have. We're moving to the annual class survey. In the annual class survey, the following items should be examined: the load line items, hull items, machinery and electrical items, and firefighting equipment. As you said before, for some types of vessel, this annual class survey is a bit enhanced. For example, for oil tankers, we have deck foam and inert gas systems, steering gear, hull, machinery, and equipment. For chemical tankers, we have, again, the steering gear, structural equipment, fittings, arrangements, and materials. And for the gas carrier, we have the steering gear, structural equipment, fittings, arrangements, and materials. So this survey should be a bit enhanced regarding this type of vessels. The intermediate class survey, we also examine the ballast tanks and the cargo spaces. The piping systems in and cargo tanks and electrical circuits in dangerous zones in oil tankers. The steering gear, the structural equipment, the fittings, arrangements and materials for the chemicals and gas carriers. We have three types of class renewal: the class renewal, the partial class renewal, and the continuous class renewal. In the class renewal, a detailed inspection of the hull and machinery together with its installation and equipment for the purpose of assigning the ship for a new period of class. The survey becomes due to an expiry of the regular period of the class, and the scope of survey depends on the age and the type of the vessel. The scope may be extended if this considered necessary by the surveyor in view of his findings. So surveyor has the control about the inspection. So if he finds something that's not according to the rules and regulation, or something that it's not according, it's not, for example, if someone is very experienced, he can see without referring to the rules and regulations something is wrong. So his findings are very important. Regarding the non-periodical surveys, we have damage and repair survey, voyage repairs, convention surveys, and extraordinary surveys, as I mentioned before. You can see here that in this cruise vessel they add an extra enough part of two decks. This is quite common also in Greek ferries that bought from Japan or from Europe, especially in the past. In the purpose of where we have a damage, for example, first of all, we have to determine the nature, the location, and the extent of the damage. We have to determine the necessary repairs with a view to the unrestricted conformation of class, or we have to determine the temporary repairs. That's very important because if the damage occurs in a place that maybe there is a bottom damage, for example, there is no place for dry dock, it should be something temporary. Otherwise, the ship should stick in this place forever. So we have to determine the temporary repairs and other measures or conditions necessary to enable the ship to proceed to the repair harbor. So there are two options of this. Either we have to do something temporary, that depends also from the damage, until to the next dry dock. So maybe the ship should have these temporary repairs for 2 years. Otherwise, something even more temporary, let's say, allows the vessel to go to the nearest dockyard, yeah, or harbor. Yes, here you can see, for example, the damage of the side cell of the RoRo passenger ship, and you can see that at least two frames suffered damage and a lot of stiffeners. This in particular vessel, it was a temporary measure that carried out until the vessel was dry docked and they cut the whole shell and they fit the new stiffeners and frames. Actually, one new frame, two new frames, and a couple of stiffeners. We have another example from the loss of anchor. This is quite common, for example, in some passenger vessels when they have a lot of port calls during their voyage, and it's quite common, yeah. And they say, for example, if there is no spare anchor or the remaining chain link cable is not adequate for anchoring, for example, if a lot of chains are lost, the following condition the class will be made. That's according to the regulation. So everything in any case, rules and regulations have the solution. So everything is written. The surveyors will refer to them and the company. The class confirm until a date on condition that the main engine is to be kept standby with vessel and anchor. The assistance of sufficiently strong tank during entry estuary training has to be applied for if deemed necessary by the master. So everything is in the rules. We have damage survey if we have fire, for example. So we can see here that after the fire, the vessel is docked and the classification society goes on board with special equipment, of course, to test whether the fire came from. What's the situation of the damage? If there's structural damage, for example, if we have aluminium superstructures, that should be very common. Of course, machinery damage. If the vessel is total loss, that's sometimes in the cards. And after that, we have the conveyance certificates, another type. But after a respective certificate survey, a conveyance certificate may be issued for severely damaged ship, enabling it to undertake the journey to the repair harbor subject to special conditions. As I said before, for example, we apply temporary survey, some panels are fitted in this the side cell, we place foam on it that's water tight, and the ship is going to the shipyard to fix the damage. Such conditions may stipulate increased freeboard, appropriate weather restrictions, and assistance from tug, etc. So, if we have, for example, large damage, or if we don't have we have a machinery failure, and we lost our power, We have a tag, and this tag should be operate until, let's say, 5 buffers, no more than that. It's not safe to operate after 5-6 buffer scale. We also have the special procedures, the condition assessment program survey. There is an inspection of the vessel to determine its technical condition, and it's according to a specified rating system. Surveys are not a requirement, but they are required by the major oil companies. So even the largest, not only the oil companies, but the gas LNG companies. But the tankers that are 15 years of age and only required the CAP, a certificate, and this program can be effectively applied to any size, type, or age of commercial ship. So classification certificate is not adequate for some companies and require extra survey, more enhanced, more detailed, with that it's focused to special characteristics of the vessel. A CAP survey covers the hull structure assessment, machinery assessment, cargo systems assessment, and the combining class of CAP survey with the vessel structural survey provides minimal disruption to the operational schedule. So they plan to carry out this survey in order to not have a large disruption to the operational profile of the vessel, so they're not looking to keep the vessel at port 10 days, no operating condition, let's say. And here's the ratings from the each program's assessment range from 1 to 4. So you can see here that the new building rating was once, so we'll never reach again the new building rating. And you can see that these ratings are increased when these surveys take place. That's because we have maintenance of the vessel during these periods. After that, we have the poor rating, that the vessel or either has to lay it up or to operate for another, to transfer to another classification society, or to operate for totally different quarters and operations. We also have the, yes, we have the change of class. For example, it's very common if a vessel is built with some class, with one class, and after transfer to another class, or if someone sold the vessel and the new owner wants to transfer to a new class, or if, even more important, if the existing class cannot cover sufficiently this ship. So there are a lot of detentions and a lot of things that the class cannot cover. So in this case, there are a lot of small classes that should carry over this vessel until the laid up of the vessel. It's common to have the vessel in the early ages, not in the first 20 years, let's say, to or more. Sometimes it's very well maintained, but in the merchant ship sometimes does not occur. And we have this, for example, this 6 or 7, I don't know how many, there are the major Ajax societies, you can see here. And after that, they transfer to some smaller classification societies that can fulfill the requirements of the vessel. So the standards are even low right now, but the vessel is still seaworthy according to these classification societies. So it's a lot of tricks over there. Now we're going to another type of surveys, the statutory surveys and certificates.
Sorry,
yes.
I didn't quite understand.
Yes.
When they go to the smaller classification, as you said.
Yes.
Like that means that they need to operate under.
For example, if they need to move to a non-Ajax classification,
yes,
society, or to an Ajax but with lower standards, this classification society has their own standards according to the structure of the ship. For example, the minimum thickness of the cells, the minimum thickness of the stiffeners, the size of the stiffeners, and the size of the thickness of the cells changes year over year. So maybe after some time they have to replace all the side cell and fit a new one. But that's why we never reach the operational level of the vessel when it's a new build. So
are they safe? Right.
Yes, they are safe. They are safe, but with lower standards.
So, for instance, for they need to be under four.
Maybe they need to operate in some other, let's say, other areas. For example, if a vessel is operating in Europe, and after that, it's quite common to operate in Philippines, Indonesia, Africa,
okay.
Or non-European EU countries like Albania. There are a lot of this type of vessels that it's quite common. Yeah. So, any other questions? I forgot to ask, sorry. The distant learners, any other questions? Okay. We're going to discuss the relationship class in the statutory surveys, the legal background behind statutory surveys, and the surveys types and intervals. You can see here the main difference between classification and statutory surveys. We discussed about classification. Now, regarding statutory surveys based on IMO conventions, codes, resolutions, as far ratified by the flag state, and additional national requirements. So there are external rules, and they passed by the flag state to the classification society. And most of the flag states approved the MARPOL and SOLAS and everything about IMO resolutions, and they translate to the national legislation. So this is a statutory surveys. So it's something completely different from the classification surveys. We're looking sometimes a lot of different things. And we have to say that the flag state authorizes the classification society. That depends on the flag state, which classification societies should authorize to carry out the statutory surveys on behalf of the flag. You can see here the relation between the classification, the Ajax, the IMO, and the administration regarding the statutory surveys in order to have to obtain the certificates for the vessel. So we can see that the administration authorized the classification, and the classification through the R&D department maybe consult the administration. So there is this type of interaction. The IMO through conventions, codes, and resolutions force the administration to not force the administration inside to conduct this type of that the administration should follow the IMO, the IMO's resolution and convention, etc. And there is a consult between Ajax and IMO, so there is continuous consulting through these two bodies. So, what means statutory regulations? As you can see, it's the requirements by the national administration. International regulations that are ratified by national administrations, and class may conduct surveys only on behalf of the flag administration. You can see here that IMO through conventions, codes, resolutions such as SOLAS, MARPOL, and Bloodline is the legal background of the statutory survey. Here are the SOLAS, MARPOL, LOTLINE, Torrance Convention, the IBC, IGC, and HGC code. They are the carrying goods of some special attention, let's say. For chemical tankers, for tankers, for gas carriers. So we apply these codes for each type of the vessel. We have the load line surveys. You can see here that the certificate of the load line issued by, for example, here from Lloyd's Register. And you can see that the in the vessel, the initials of each classification society, the GL means now it's former GL, it's now DNV GL, but the GL stands for Germanister Lloyd, and they should be placed in the load line of the vessel. We have safety construction surveys, safety equipment surveys, safety radio surveys, and MARPOL surveys. Classification societies, if they approve from the flag, should carry out these types of surveys. They are also periodically, so they are maybe for 1-2 years or sometimes more. And as the class surveys, we have renewal. Now we're going to discuss about the periodical, the special cases, such as the Enhanced Survey Program, ESP, as Panagiotis mentioned before, and the Condition Assessment Scheme, CAS. Surveyor is responsible to carry out the ESP, and the legal background is a hull survey for oil tankers, chemical tankers, and bulk carriers, according to the resolution A744. And we follow the IAX guidelines to carry out an ESP. The aim of the Enhanced Survey Program is to survey items that are more detailed than a periodical survey, and as a result, the detailed survey of the hull structure within the cargo tank and hull length is identified in more detail. The ballast tanks, the cargo and ballast piping systems, the pump rooms, coffer dams, etc. The Condition Assessment Scheme, the CAS, so it started applied from 2003, but the first regulation was in April 2001, where MPEC 46 approved to accelerate the phasing out of single hull oil tankers. And the last single hull tanker of 5,000 tons dead weight and above, but less than tons specified for category one, two tankers will be phased out by 2015 and hence will not be allowed to enter ports of EU member states. So after a lot of accidents, as Erika, Prestige, not Prestige, was the double kind of thing. A lot of accidents that Exxon Valdez, that's the accident that forced that in EU waters, a single hull tankers are not allowed to operate, only double hull, in order to, in case of grounding, etc., not have oil spill. Condition assessment scheme will have to be applied to all Category 1 vessels continuing to trade after 2005 and all Category 2 vessels after 2010 in order to assume permanent good maintenance, according to the MPEC condition 94, etc., resolution according to 94 and 99, 112. So this CAS is based on these MPEC resolutions. The MPEC stands for Marine Environment Protection Committee from IMO. The scope of the CAS includes the hull structure and way of the cargo tanks, pump rooms, coffer dams, pipe tunnels, and void spaces. And after successfully completed CAS, a certificate is issued from the flag state that has a validity of 5 years. Is it everything clear? After that, we have onboard surveys. We're going to talk the who is authorized to conduct these surveys and what measures have to be taken in order to prepare a survey to conduct, what's the report of these surveys, and after that, if everything is successful, about the certification of the survey. So, IGEX class societies are authorized to carry out statutory functions by most of the flag states. And these authorizations include attendance to matters stipulated by the most important conventions concerning ship safety and marine environment protection, which are supplemented to a varying degree by national safety regulations. So, who are the involved parties of the of these surveys? First of all, the IGEX Quality Committee, that is the governing body of QSCS. QSCS stands for Quality System Certification Scheme, and we have the IGEX Advisory Committee, accredited certification bodies, IGEX Quality Secretary, and IGEX Council. We have some auditors to be trained, and we have audit of process and surveys object, the ACB assessment and improvement, the IGEX end user workshop, and internal audits. So, FLAG should confirm that the classification society follows the regulations, and we have these internal audits, I think, at least once per year, if I'm right. A classification society with staff of 1,500 people and 50 branches worldwide, so it's quite a big class, conducts every year about 80 internal audits and 20 vertical contract audits. So we can see there is a lot of interaction, a lot of control from the flag to the classification society. So classification society cannot be, for example, unworthy regarding the statutory surveys. And here's the RO code. As a flag state may delegate authority to an organization recognized as compliant with the provisions of this code to perform on its behalf statutory certification and services under mandatory IMO instruments and national legislation, that the delegation of authority. Regarding the recognition authorization requirements for organizations, authorization of required organizations says that under the provisions of regulation size 6 of SOLAS 1974, article 30, blah, 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 and the flag state may authorize an RO to act on its behalf in statutory certification and receive services and determination of tonnages only to ships entitled to fly its flag as required by these conventions. Such authorizations are not required ROs to perform actions that infringe the on the rights of another flag state. And finally, we have the oversight of the part three, the oversight of recognized organizations, the principles of auditing, where it mentions clearly that the flag state should be satisfied that the RO has an effective quality management system in place. The flag state may rely upon the audits carried out by the accredited certification body or equivalent organizations. So everything is controlled and monitored through the RO code. It's a very, very important part for statutory surveys, for a flag to perform statutory surveys. So we have also the annual QSCS audits, and they are taking place in the head office or one controlling office, if any. I think that this is if the control office is major control office. The office is not some, not a small one. The one plan approval center ensuring geographic coverage over a 3-year period and to the full extent of PA activities, plan approval activities. The vertical contract audits, the VCA, dependent on fleet size covering, there are minimum 6 VCAs per year, and they are for ships in service, new constructions regarding the ASM and ISPS codes, and material and equipment certification. So there's not only the head offices, but also to the they monitor how the classification society perform their surveys. It's very important. And also we have audits for additional survey locations according to the IFMD5. So this is another another story of QSCS audits. So how we have to prepare a survey? Before we, as a surveyor goes on board, we have to ensure that the vessel in service and the survey should be successful. The ship, the master, and the crew is, are prepared. So it's not only the ship to be prepared for the survey, but also the crew should be perform accordingly. So they know how to operate. They know, they should know everything about their tasks on board. And this one is important because the surveyor will start to collect impressions from even before the time he takes his first step into the gangway, and continue to do until he takes the last steps of the gangway. And it's very important to see the ship before going on board. For example, if we can see a lot of fresh paint, it's not so good, because fresh paint means that something should be covered. If the result of rust, obviously, it's not so good. But there are impressions, and there are things that, according to experience, as more experienced the surveyor is, and when the classification society has an extensive record history of the vessel, they know the deficiencies, they know what they have to see, they know, I think, everything. So it's quite difficult for the crew line to the, or the company line to the classification society, because I think classification society is also as an advisory body to the company, not something to control them and take from them money. Before going on a survey, we have to plan it. Okay, and first of all, we have to plan the ship schedule. We have to ensure that the ship will be on port when the survey is going to take place. And for example, the vessel is at sea at the date of the expiry of the certificate, they will have to plan the survey at the port, just in the previous port before the expiry of the certificate. We have to ensure suitable location. For example, we have to ensure that the ship is a safe place, if not harbor to a tanker, but with not so winds, that should be operable for the surveyor to conduct the survey. To request a surveyor in a timely manner. For example, I'm not here in Glasgow in surveyor, and they call me to go to Timbuktu tomorrow to conduct the survey. Discuss surveys with surveyor in advance to know the scope of survey, so to know where we have to focus, the deficiency, to prepare all the machinery that should be tested, monitored, to have enough time for survey, that's actually overwhelming, to ensure that crew may demonstrate operations if required, to plan before cutting out repairs, and advise class, discuss with the class, prior to the repair, we have to consider the class regulations, because sometimes we'll do something to the company and it's not according to the class societies, and they have to do it again, they lose money, time, etc. And it's quite common. And after that, it's a very complicated story, and sometimes they don't want to conform with the regulations. Yes. And of course, we have to provide a directly certified space. Repairs. In order to conduct a survey, we have to ensure that all the documentation is ready. So in the accommodation space of the vessel, some room, usually the meeting room, that depends, or the bridge, all the documentation of the vessel should be ready. We have to ensure the machinery and spaces are very well prepared. for example, the cooldown, we don't have to perform a machinery survey with the engine in operation or with the when the engines just stop. And all the mountings should be opened, the tanks open, and I can add here that in a special survey, we have to have all the sea chests open to see what's going on there. It's very important. So all the openings of the vessel should be open. And the chain should be it's not should be should not be in the chain locker, should be in the dry dock. In the chain was not because we have to identify the broken chains, the broken yes, everything. The survey methods depends on the scope of the intended survey, and possible survey methods are the visual and overall inspection, the visual close-up examination, and audit of the maintenance history. And of course, the witness testing, the function test, and tightness test. So visual is one of the most important methods to see if something's going wrong or something's going well, etc. During the inspection, we have to ensure that the surveyor is accompanied around the vessel during the inspection by either the master or a senior officer, the chief officer, the second, so but not a member of the crew, just because they have to. And I have to add here that the surveyor is not responsible to operate, for example, the radio during the survey. This has to ask to the master or to someone else to operate it from him and test if everything's worked properly. And that occurs from all the machinery parts, the everything, the electrical parts, everything on board. So regular should not operate on his own. A surveyor.
Yes.
Surveyors are trained, but they want to ensure that also the crew is.
So for instance, they are trained even for electric specific.
What?
Electric specific? No,
electronic charts.
Yes.
I don't know if they know how to. Okay, I'm back. As I said, we have to check visibility if the waters are clear. The availability of in-water documentation and instructions and approved copy. The measuring tools from propeller shaft and rudder, for example, to have a filler, something like that to ensure the distance between the shaft and the tail shaft, etc. The availability of tools and equipment, cover for sea chest, etc. So all the appropriate equipment should be carried out in water survey. And we have to survey. Survey is not going underwater. He has the diver for it, the survey, and they have either a VHS, VHF, let's say, or walkie-talkie communication, and of course a video. It's quite important to the diver to have a video, a camera to record all the findings. The in-water surveys are carried out for vessels maintaining the class with the notation IW. That is also for the GL classification society, but the same classification societies have the same notations or similar notations. The substitute for every second bottom survey in dry dock except class renewal, because of course the class renewal the ships should be in dry dock, and conducted only with approved diver companies. That's very important to have someone approved from the classification society or from a similar classification society, but Ajax one, in order to conduct the diving. Regarding the procedure we have to follow before going to the ballast water tank, we have to ensure that the ventilation is proper for a surveyor to verify the access of the tank through the manholes, etc. The gas concentration, so we have to measure the gas concentration that should be under a specific limit in order to enter the tank. The cleanliness of the tank, you can see here that this tank especially is not so clean, and there is a lot of mud from the ballast water, so we cannot see properly what's going in the bottom. It's very difficult. And security equipment, the personnel company will get into the tank. That means that the surveyor does not going alone in the ballast tank, but someone else always as a member of the crew, but someone that knows the vessel. It's very important. Communication through VHF. We have to, if someone goes wrong, maybe the torch is not working, we don't have light, let's say, to assist someone that it's someone else that's on board. And safety equipment such as breathing apparatus. This is not to happen all the time, but it's not necessary all the time. That depends on the tank, etc. But there are a lot of findings we can see that in the ballast tank. This is the most, let's say, most of the damages should be found in the ballast tanks because of the seawater. It makes a lot of damage in the hull. We also to ensure properly that all the critical items on board should be working properly, such as the maintenance safety equipment, the firefighting and fire flaps. We have to conduct tests using the fire pumps of the vessel to see what's the pressure of the fire pumps, to ensure that all the fire extinguishers are not expired, to ensure that the hatch covers are properly maintained and there's no leakage of water, etc. And of course, the air and sound fire sensors, that one. That should be also yes. And after that, we issue the survey report, if it's successful or if it's not. Most of the classification societies have an electronic procedure of this. You can see here the class NK, for example, the electronic report. The surveyor has a laptop or tablet or something from the classification society, and during the time of the surveying, for example, not when he's in the ballast tank, he's not going with his laptop, for example, but he has the laptop with him, And he just checks if everything is okay that he's seen. And after completing this report online, transfer to the head offices or to the local office, that depends on the classification society, and the survey report is produced. So after the survey, the classification society story does not end here, and the certificate should be endorsed, for example, for annual intermediate. We have the certificate should be extended, and maybe a new certificate will be issued, a renewal. So there are a lot of options, and I think that always classification society is in closely cooperation with the ship owner, the ship company. We have also some other types of surveys, such as flag deck inspection, port state control, vetting inspection, sale and purchase, and inspection of the ship in general. Regarding the flag state, surveys carried out by nominated inspectors of the flag, I know a surveyor, they have to check of technical and operational requirements, and they have to report to the flag states. The port state control is very important. It's conducted by each coastal country and port state. The resolution A787-822, the Memorandum of Understanding, is the background of the port state control. And United Coast Guard also check national regulations. We can say that the US Coast Guard is very strict and regarding the port state control. And there are a lot of cases that the ships should not be operating in U.S. waters after a post-state control survey. And there are a lot of fines to the companies for a lot of reasons. It's very strict. The aims are of the post-state control is to check for compliance with international convention regulation. And the post-state control report handed over to the master after the survey took place, the report should be either positive or negative. The scope of inspection of the port state control should be a general inspection and an impression of the ship in general, let's say. A more detailed inspection with clear grounds should be carried out. An expanded inspection if something is obviously wrong. And concentrated inspection campaign should be carried out as well. The port state control officer decides by his professional judgment if if we have detention or not. And all the deficiencies regarding technical and operation should be recorded into the documentation. We have now the vetting inspections. It's carried out by surveyors and inspectors in general. The background based on contracts and agreements, and it's behalf of the owners of all potential characters. We have, for example, for some specific type of vessels, for oil tankers, we have SIRE, where it follows the oil company's marine forum, international marine forum inspection criteria, and we have for the chemical and gas carriers, the CDI, that follows the Council of Europe Federation of Chemical Industry. So for each type of vessel, for each type of operating area, we have vetting inspection. The aim is to assess a risk survey, and the results are pro forma inspection reports that should be available. And upon a completion of survey, a database will be uploaded with inspection results, and these results are available to use to the users of the CDI and I can say the other one, the SIRE, the tankers and the chemical gases. The evaluation of inspection report allows interest parties assessment. And also, if a specific ship company comply with own standards, or if it's suitable for being chartered to another company, or if it's suitable to load and discharge at own terminal. So the findings should give us information about this district. Sure. Yes. It should be.
Okay.
It should be. should not be it's not the same way for the superintendent engineers. Something different. The company has to. We also have the sale and purchase inspection that is conducted from inspectors and surveyors, and there is an agreement between the owners and buyers about the time and the type of survey. So before to sell the ship, the decision after the survey, a decision for making the purchase and the costs, if any, should be carried out. The result if the contract of for sale and purchase is going to take place or not. So it's very important for the new owner, the possible new owner, to have a sale and purchase survey to see if the vessel is seaworthy, or if it's not, what the cost to make it again seaworthy. And we have now the general inspection of the ship that is conducted from the superintendent of the company, in order to comply with the internal rules of the company, agreements, and the quality system, and maybe sometimes before the vessel goes to United States water, where the coast guard takes place. So in order to ensure that everything is okay before something, the coast guard finds something, we have to ensure that the vessel is properly operating. The aims are to maintain the maintenance planning, the preparation of the repair, and that I just said before, and an internal report or repair findings should be the results of the inspection of the ship, the general inspection of the ship. So that's my presentation. Thanks very much. Do you have any questions? Any questions? No, it's everything clear then. That's good.